All right, everybody, this is Mr. Fugu. You're watching Mr. Fugu Data Science. If you want the code, it'll be provided on my GitHub, Mr. Fugu Data Science. If you would like to show some support and follow me on Twitter, get a hold of me at Mr. Fugu Data Sci. Now, we're doing a continuation of our last video right here. Well, we have some mineral data. This is a three-part series. You are watching part two, where we're converting this data into adjacency list and looking for trends. Now, let's look at where we left off from last time. Already, we created a condensed or consolidated list of minerals. All right. Now, we took that list and we concatenated onto our existing data frame, which is here. And what we were doing was saying, all right, we take these data. I shouldn't have just hit that, but all right. We take these data and we have to say, if we have, let's say, uranium, is it occurring in any other of these rows? All right. So we say, okay, it occurred in 10,366 rows. Okay, that's perfect. Well, I was having trouble figuring out, is this even printing out anything other than false? And that's why I had to do this to make sure I did this correctly. Now, to note, we have a lot of columns. We have 168 columns. This is some pretty wide data, but it's also pretty long too. It's 304,632 rows. So it's a decent sized little data set. We have to take that data and convert our data frame into a JSON object now. We're going to do that by creating this function df to GeoJSON, where we throw in as our parameters our data frame, the properties we would like to add to this file, as well as the longitude and latitude. You will be iterating through your dictionary, your data frame as a dictionary. That's why you have this as your key value pairs. And if you're unfamiliar with GeoJSON formatting, you can look on Wikipedia and it'll show you that you have a nested JavaScript dictionary where you're saying, all right, we have our type, we have feature collection inside of our type, we have a key of features, which is creating a list, where we have our geometry that stores our data, which will be, in our case, a point, but it could be polygons, I'll show you later. Then our coordinates of latitude and longitude. So we say, okay, let's iterate through, create a variable named feature, where we say, all right, let's go through our type. From the type, we go into properties, and we create our dictionary. Inside of that, we say, all right, let's take our geometry, where we're taking our point data, and store our latitude and longitude. And we say, okay, cool. So now we take that, and now we need to actually add it in accordingly from outer to inner. So we start at geometry, then we go inside and go into coordinates. Start at geometry, go inside, do our coordinates. Perfect. Then we have to iterate through this and say, all right, let's take our little feature variable, and let's go inside of properties, iterate through that, and add it in there. We say, okay, cool. Let's look at that. So that's what's going on here. That's the separate stuff that we're adding in, you'll see. So then we say, all right, now we have our feature as a key and we append our list of features. So we say, okay, here's our features and now we're appending our list where everything else is going inside of it. Cool. And then we return our GeoJSON object. We take a list of the columns that we decided we're going to input into this, and we put those here, which is our site name, state, commodity 1, country, latitude, and longitude. And you could expand this to whatever parameters you need. And you could say, okay, now let's create that, and we'll take our data frame and our column names, and we'll store that. Perfect. Then we print that out and look at our features and say, well, what does this really look like, so we could see that this actually worked. And when you actually run this function and store this, it does take a minute or two. It takes a little while to iterate through that nest list or nest dictionary. So here's our properties. There's the site name. There's our state, commodity 1, country, latitude, longitude, our point data, and our coordinates. Then does it for the next one and keeps on going. Perfect. So now I say, well, let me just arbitrarily choose some type of element to do some exploration work and see how this stuff's working. So I say, all right, let me just take uranium, find everything where uranium is available, store this from our data frame as uranium. Then I just was lazy and just stored this. I said, all right, let me alias this as df underscore uranium, throw it into our GeoJSON df function. And then I print that out and say, okay, now I found everything that has uranium. If you see uranium, as well as other elements that are with it, minerals, metals, and such. So I say, okay, cool. So we know that this is working. Now I have to take a file that's called world.geojson, which is this file. And it is a GeoJSON format as well. And so basically what this is all the countries in the world where their point data is now a bunch of points considered a polygon. And this polygon is creating the outer perimeter of what the countries look like. So it's like putting a bunch of dots together and then creating an object from there. And so this is the point. So this is Afghanistan and Angola and etc. So we take this. This will be used for our plotting later. And we need to read in this file. Then we go inside of features, and we're iterating through this file. And what we're doing is we're making a comparison of all the country names that are in the GeoJSON world file and comparing it against the mineral deposit countries. All right? And then you're saying, all right, there's going to be an error thrown if our files don't coincide with the other. So we say, okay, cool. Then we say, well, if they actually are there, then let's put them inside of our dictionary. All right. And then I say, all right, I need to open, write a separate file now called mineralcountries.geojson. And dump that file that we're just creating with everything we did here above. So everything after you store it and say everything's good, then you store it as a file, and then we'll read it back in so we can actually use it. From the mineral data file comparing it against the world GeoJSON, this is all of the countries that weren't available for data we could use for plotting. Mainly because most of the data we are obtaining are from the United States Geological Services, USGS. So we say, all right, now we could do us a little bit of plotting with Bokeh. And be like, okay, let's see what's going on there. So we go in here, and we were going to use the uranium data. We got a cool little thing called a hover tool, which is basically like a cursor that hovers over everything, and I'll show you what's going on. And one thing to know that there are some mistakes within the data with labeling, and if there wasn't a label provided, your output is a question mark, and you'll see that in a second. So say, okay, we will open our mineral GeoJSON file, or write a mineral GeoJSON file. And we're basically dumping, we're basically dumping this file. We're reading it back in as a JSON data source. Then I have to call from Bokeh these tools, pan, wheel zoom, box zoom, reset, and save. Okay, cool. Then I create a title for my figure. I input the tools that we're using. I am not creating an axis location of Y and X, and I created the size of our height and width for our plot. And then I'm not going to have any coloring if you're doing a grid. And then patches we're adding in. Your source is going to be your GeoJSON data source that you're calling. So that's what this is, the world geo source. All right. And then the geo source is what we're going to be using for our little dots for all the places. Here, I'll show you. So these are like the site names and states. See, some of them work, some of them don't. It just depends on what was labeled. And you're adding in here what you want to show up on the hover tool. You could expand more of the parameters that you put inside of your GeoJSON stuff. I can't remember the order of this, but one of them is what you're calling from the GeoJSON file. The other one is what you're aliasing as a name. I can't remember the order. And that's what's going on here. So you, as you see, most of these are in the United States. So it's pretty cool. It does work. Uh-oh, something's rendering and locked up my computer. Why is this happening? Okay. Then we're going to stop the video here. And next video, we will be doing the adjacency list, finishing off with some more plotting, and then we'll call it good. So I want to say thank you for watching. I hope you like this video. Please get the code from my GitHub. And as always, throw a like if you thought this was a good comment. Please subscribe, and see you in the next video. Ciao.